Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in. I'm Zach Peterson. I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna look at a viewer question on capacitors. And this is a little follow-up to our discussion of PDN impedance in a previous video. Tim Peng writes, "Hey Zach, your recent series about power integrity PDN and capacitors is really decent. I wonder if you heard about controlled ESR capacitors, which work wonderful when it comes to PDN design. Not sure if you can walk us through this topic in a coming video." So controlled ESR capacitors are a specific type of capacitor where the ESR value, or the effective series resistance value, tends to be a bit higher than what you might find in other capacitors. Also, the manufacturer guarantees a specific range, including a minimum value for the ESR in that capacitor. So let's look at how these specific types of capacitors affect PDN impedance. They're not a magic bullet, but I'll show you why they might be useful. Let's get started. So let's do a quick review on the typical circuit model that you use to model a capacitor. So when we have a capacitor, this is the symbol that you use, but this is really modeled as a resistor in series with a capacitance in series with some inductance. So this is your effective series resistance, this is your capacitance, and this is your effective series inductance. And so together, a real capacitor behaves like an RLC network. This means that it has a resonant frequency, it has a resonance where there will be a minimum impedance, and then above that resonant frequency, inductance takes over and it behaves more like an inductor. Now, with a controlled ESR capacitor, the important point here is, of course, the ESR value, or the effective series resistance. The ESR value being controlled means that it's set within a specific range and there is a minimum value that it gets specified for the ESR value in that capacitor. What this question really relates to is, how does a higher ESR value or a slightly higher effective series resistance affect your PDN impedance spectrum? So if you watch the previous video on transient responses in a PDN and the PDN impedance, you'll know that if I have a PDN impedance spectrum, this is my Z for impedance, this is frequency, it tends to look something like this, and it has these spikes in it. And then eventually at higher frequencies, just erase that here, it starts to look inductive again. Okay, so this isn't the greatest drawing, but hopefully you kind of get the idea, is that you have these different peaks and valleys here in the impedance spectrum. And so together, all of this bandwidth that's in the impedance spectrum will determine the transient response in your PDN when your digital components start switching and start pulling current into the PDN from the voltage regulator module. What this affects here, what the ESR affects, is it affects how these different peaks appear in the PDN impedance spectrum. So I'm gonna erase all of this, and if you haven't watched the previous video yet, go watch the previous video, come back, and then we'll look at this in a little bit more detail. Okay, so now what I wanna do is look at what happens to the impedance in your PDN as you start adding capacitors in parallel in the PDN. Now remember, when you have decoupling capacitors, you're using them for power integrity in your digital PDN, essentially what you're doing is you're placing a whole bunch of capacitors in parallel. And it's that parallel arrangement of capacitors that determines the shape of the PDN impedance spectrum and how the different impedance curves from each capacitor overlap to give you that overall PDN impedance. So let's just assume for a moment that here I have my graph for my PDN impedance, Z versus F, and I have one capacitor and its impedance looks something like this. So this is my first resonant frequency. Then I have another capacitor and its impedance spectrum maybe looks something like this. And this is its resonant frequency. So these frequencies are the self-resonance frequency of the capacitor. And if you look back at the previous circuit model for a capacitor, it's that RLC network and that resonant frequency for that RLC network that determines this value of F1. So for this, F1, this is just equal to 1 over 2 pi square root of ESL 1 times C1. And then we have the same type of equation for F2. Instead of a 1 here, I would just have a 2. So you can look up those values in the data sheet. Now you might be wondering, what does the ESR value affect? How does the ESR value play into this? So first, let's look at what the equivalent impedance spectrum of this would be. The equivalent impedance spectrum for this PDN would essentially be something like this black curve. The red and the green portion above where this overlap is essentially disappears because we have these two capacitors in parallel. Here, it's if I have F1 and F1 has a slightly higher ESR value than F2, what happens is the PDN impedance for F1 or the F1 section spreads out a little bit. So here the impedance comes up a little bit, but it actually flattens out. And so it's a really nice way to try and flatten out this impedance curve compared to what happens when you have very low ESR value capacitors. So a typical ESR value for a capacitor that you might use in a digital PDN could be as low as 50 milliohms. However, controlled ESR capacitors could have much higher ESR value, and that's one of the reasons that you would use them, is to get this higher ESR value, which then flattens out the impedance spectrum a little bit. And so those values could be somewhere in the neighborhood of 500 milliohms, so quite a bit bigger. And that's what then determines this shape of this portion of the curve. So we're just referring to F1 here. If we did the same thing for F2, let's say we wanted to use a high ESR value capacitor for F2, well, again, instead of having this deep curve here that then rises up very quickly, we would have something that is a bit of a slower transition into the inductive region, and then a little bit higher impedance. But you'll notice that this region of the PDN impedance spectrum is actually flatter. So that's not a bad thing. Essentially what it means is that you might be able to use a smaller number of capacitors to bring down the PDN impedance to a lower level. However, the PDN impedance spectrum could be flatter as a result. So if your target impedance, let's say, is right here with the low ESR capacitors, you'll notice that this curve just started to touch my target impedance value. And so it would be nice to start bringing that whole curve down. So in order to do that, we would just use more of our F1 capacitors and then more of our F2 capacitors. However, with some higher ESR capacitors, I'm able to actually smooth this out and bring the entire curve below my PDN impedance spectrum, but without using more of F1 and without using more of F2. Instead, what I did is I just swapped out whatever my capacitors are for F1 with some different capacitors. So capacitor selection here is really important. And essentially what it means is that you could actually get to a slightly lower impedance, or at least below your target, using fewer capacitors than you would with low ESR value capacitors. Don't fear high ESR values. It's not that high ESR value is necessarily bad. What's really important is that you look at how the different capacitors pair up in parallel to give you this overall impedance spectrum. So I went ahead and did a simulation in one of the blogs that we're gonna link in the description. In that simulation, I actually compare what happens when you have multiple of these curves overlapping each other with different ESR value capacitors in the PDN impedance network. Take a look at that blog, take a look at that graph. You'll actually be able to see how you transition between this curve with low ESR and this curve with higher ESR. And you'll see that for two individual capacitors when you have a network of 20 capacitors all in parallel. So you might be wondering, why do we have this effect when we increase ESR? So if I use a higher ESR capacitor here, why do I get this flattening effect here in this region of the PDN? And why isn't it the case that this entire section of the curve just moves up but keeps the same shape? So to explain that, we have to look at fundamental circuit theory and look at a series RLC circuit. Because remember, each of these capacitors is really a series RLC circuit. And you can see what that circuit looks like earlier in this video. So that R value in your series RLC circuit is just your equivalent series resistance. So let's just graph out what the impedance of an RLC circuit looks like. And this is just gonna be a sketch. It's not gonna be a very accurate graph, but you'll get kind of a sense for what happens with the shape of this graph. So here I have my impedance of my RLC circuit. And when I have a low R value, the curve is gonna look something like this, okay? So we have a nice sharp peak here that has a very clear resonance frequency, just call it F sub R, and then we have a very sharp transition up into the inductive region in this graph. Now, if I have a high value for R in my RLC circuit, it's gonna look something like this. So we've got a gentler transition, we have a higher impedance at resonance, And we have still the same behavior, though. We do have a resonance. And so as you continue to increase R in this circuit, eventually this curve will start to flatten out. So here, this is an even higher value for R. And eventually, you won't even have a resonance anymore. So this R, or this resistor in this RLC circuit, provides damping for the transient response. And it eventually converts the typical underdamped response, which is what you see on a PDN, or what you'll typically see on a PDN, into a critically damped response, and then eventually into an overdamped response, where there isn't an oscillation anymore, and there's just a very smooth transition in the response in this circuit due to a transient event. So hopefully this type of curve that you see here explains why we get this type of result that you would see here in a simulation for your PDN. So if you want to do some simulations that actually show you these types of curves for a group of capacitors in your power delivery network, you don't need a really complex simulation tool. You can actually do it with SPICE. Now, there are some limitations when you use SPICE, but what you can do is you can use equivalent circuit models for your capacitors, put your capacitors all in parallel, and then look at what happens as you change the different values of ESR or ESL or C, and you can see how the shape of the impedance curve starts to change. So in a SPICE package, just remember, you're not accounting for plane capacitance, so the capacitance between the power and the ground plane. You're also not accounting for any types of parasitic inductance due to traces or due to the planes themselves. So that's an important thing to remember. You're only looking at what happens to this group of capacitors arranged very close together in parallel. Just make sure that you're using equivalent circuit models for your capacitors. Don't just assume that some component that you pull in from a library is going to include the ESR or ESL value. Okay, everybody, thanks for watching. If you like this video, hit that like button. If you want to see more videos, hit that subscribe button. Leave your comments below. Make sure to check out the blog link in the description. And if you want to get a free trial of Altium Designer, again, it's in the description. Go check it out. Thanks again, everybody. And don't forget to call your fabricator.